Einen wunderschönen guten Morgen, a beautiful good morning, welcome, hello, aloha, tiens, dir tut, ciao, welcome to Austria. We welcome you all to the HL Austria 2018 here in Graz, in the green, green center of Austria. We welcome all the Scrum Masters, the Masters of Scrum, the Scrum Trainers, the Scrumish, the CEOs, the CFOs, the CTOs, the C-whatever-os, also all Scrum team members, the product owners, the owners of some companies, a very warm welcome. We start the conference with a green dot. If you look into your package that you got, you will find a green dot. Because sometimes it's all about if we are at first name basis or at last name basis. So if you want to be spoken to with your first name, you put on a green dot. Mine is there, so you can call me with whatever name you like. And I hope the green dots are really in there because I see you all. Okay? Yeah, the first experiment gone wrong today. No dot? Okay, good, good. So there's fail fast, the first fail, that's fine for me. I just continue, thank you very much. Oh, that's quite a good idea. So you wanna like just take the pen and draw like a nice circle on your shirt? No, okay, yeah. Okay, just make a dot on yourself wherever it works. And to start officially the conference, I would invite here on stage our three organizers. There needs to be people who have like the money, the courage, the trust in the people, and the will to do something. So please, welcome with me on the stage Wolfgang Richter von Jeep, Gerhard Hammer from Apus, and Jörg Steinbauer from Bearing Point.
Okay. Yeah. Very warm welcome also from my side. My name is Gerhard Hammer from Apus in the middle there. And I'm really proud and it's a pleasure for me standing here. And the absolutely most important thing that all of you are here now and are awaiting a very inspiring 2 days conference. That's what I'm wishing for all of us.
Thank you. My name is Wolfgang Richter from Chip IT. We tried to fix the green dot issue. Do we have an information for that? Oh, they are at the registration, so you can find them there. They weren't in the bags. So, but that's all it is about, experiments, trying out new things. I mean, we changed from last year to this year already some things, and we think we improved it. Of course, some things can go wrong, but that's all it is about for the next 2 days. Listening to people, trying out experiments in workshops, and just enjoy it.
So, welcome to Graz. Welcome again to Graz. My name is Jörg Steinbauer from Bearing Point, and it's the second time that we are here in Graz, but coming back here, it's like joining a family, an agile family, and so I think it's a great success of everyone who supports to organize this conference on the one hand, to all our employees, to the people, to all everybody, and I think also to you who are again joining this conference. So have fun for the next 2 days and enjoy the day.
Thank you very much. And in a conference is also about talking. And if you talk with people about agile, sometimes you think you have no clue what they are talking about. So I want to get into this later, but I'm interested in what's your personal definition of agile and can you do it in one sentence?
For sure, that's a completely unexpected question for me. So it's really difficult to answer this question, but I make it as short as possible. For me, it's a mathematic item. And for me personally, Scrum equals social mankind.
Yeah, for me, I describe agility with one other word, actually, which means adaptive, being able to react to change, so which is in the Agile Manifesto. I think that's the essence for me for agility.
So if we talk about agile people who are maybe elderly, we think they are physically and mentally fit. And I think what's more and more important is to be mentally fit and to have this agile mindset. And I think it's everything about the people who are driving an organization to be agile. And that's for me the point.
Perfect. Thank you very much. So you already noticed I have three big bosses here on stage, and even here, it's slightly not the same. It's not completely maybe compatible, maybe it is, but I just wanted to point this out. I say thank you very much, and I will come back on this later. Thank you, and enjoy the conference also. After we got the people responsible, if this is working or not, we've got a roof, and we are grateful for that. And I'm asking Magister Burkhard Neuper, please, on stage from the Chamber of Commerce Styria. Welcome.
Hello. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome in your house. It's the house of entrepreneurs. It's the house of the business. Thank you for being here, the organizers. It's a pleasure to have you here for this international touch. We are very proud of that. And I hope you will find a lot of good ideas and inputs for your daily work and business. And we hope that we can support you from our embassy, from the chamber, yeah. From the chamber to get rid of your daily problems. We have a lot of services, and please call us if you have any questions. You know, we have a lot of to do with the DSGVO topics. So please contact us, contact Dr. Werner Lemmerer. He is the head of the chamber IT and consulting, and please get in contact with us. We can help you in a lot of cases. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and thank you that we can spend our conference on our roof. Thank you, Jean. So, and after this, we of course we need sponsors and partners for this. And before I read the long list of sponsors and partners, I want to try this and also wake you up. So I've got here people on my left side and people on my right side. And what we want to try is, first of all, wake you up with the beat. So could you please stamp with your feet one time now? Just the left side, okay? And now we try it in a beat, you know? And stamp. Stamp, stamp, stamp. Okay, continue until your feet fall off. Thank you. You can maybe imagine what you can do. You clap on the opposite. So it's like stomp, clap, stomp, clap, stomp, clap, stomp, clap. Yes. We will welcome everybody to our conference. We start with Boris Kloger, the head of the chance. We've got Computer World and Economy, the HL experts, consult training coach. They're not the only one, just the HL tour and less. Connect Biz Academy. We got HL me for the Middle East, viable products. PerfectNet, here we go, Archie Pro Consulting and ITCS. If nothing ever works, you can join the Scrum user group. Graz, the Freiräume, Less, and ECXIO. Thank you very much. I hope I got everybody, otherwise it will be the second fail today. And now I want to welcome Andrea. We are first name basis, right? Okay, third strike today, so you can really fail on stage here. From Boris Gloria Consulting on stage, please. And you want to tell us something about your company, right?
Thank you. So good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Andrea Chapova from Boris Kloger Consulting, and we are very thrilled to be one of the main sponsors here this year at the Agile Austria. So we are an Agile consultancy. We're based in Germany and in Austria, and we've been around since 2010. And our main goal is to support our customers in their projects and help them to turn their visions into sustainable products by using Agile methods. We as a company, we obviously work in a very agile manner ourselves. So we have self-organized teams, we have very transparent communication system, and our whole company culture evolves around the five agile values that you see on screen now. So we've got respect, courage, focus, openness, and commitment. However, there's another very important value hidden amongst these, and that's the value of trust. And trust is very important for us for two main reasons. So on one hand side, obviously, our customers come to us because they trust our expertise, they trust that we can help them to succeed in their projects in a more efficient way. And secondly, because they trust to try out new methods and they trust to try new ways of thinking that they might have not even considered in their organization before. So besides Agile consulting, we also offer a wide range of trainings with the possibility to do a certification at the very end. We have evolved our portfolio over the years. So we've started off with teaching about Scrum, and now we've got a whole wide range of Agile methods that we teach in our business. And you will also find a lot of publications from us. So Boris has written a wide series of books, and there's also a lot of how-to videos about agile management on YouTube. We focus mostly on the automotive, banking, and insurance industry. And as I said before, we operate mostly from Germany and Austria. However, we have now started also working on international projects abroad, and we have just recently across the 50 employees mark, so we have now a medium-sized business. So that's a very, very short snapshot of our company. If you want to find more about us, I would like to give you three pointers towards the end. So first of all, just shortly after me, you'll have the keynote from Boris Kloger talking about agile management and how it works, so I'm sure you'll find out a bit more about our company in there. Secondly, I would like to invite you to come and visit us at our booth and speak to myself or one of my colleagues. And last but not least, please visit our website. You'll find all relevant information there, trainings or events that we're organizing in the next weeks. So that's it from my side, and I'd like to wish you a very good conference, and I hope to meet a lot of you at our booth later on.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, this time, the motto of the conference is the future of Agile. Gerhard Hammer already told us about the vision last year, and he already mentioned it today. There were beautiful words. I couldn't remember. What was your term? Agile equals social mankind. And last time, we had the picture of the Earth. And last year, we had the heart of Agile here. Now we are looking into the future, and that's why I'm pointing out how to explain Agile. Because if we want to discuss just a simple word or a term, maybe it's time that we start also to try to understand each other. So this time we have the possibility to shape the future together. But first, we need a discussion. And this is where the whole setting, our whole sprint goal of this conference is. And one guy I had the chance to do an interview with, I asked him actually, Jürgen, are you sure that an Agile conference has a value at all?
Oh, of course. Well, it is valuable. The first line of the Agile Manifesto says individuals and interactions over processes and tools. So we need to enable individuals and interactions to connect, and that is what conferences and workshops are for, so that people can share the thinking and then be inspired by each other.
And I think that's true. So if we look at the program, it's fully packed, but maybe you have the time especially tonight at the mingle, that you can talk about each other. What's agile? What does it mean? Where are maybe the differences, but where are also the similarities? We are here, and Jürgen said it perfect. The first line is interactions over processes and tools. But the process of the today's conference is not that we do a lean coffee for 2 days and you will self-organize everything. This time we have at 9 o'clock the welcome and the keynote, then a block of program, 12 o'clock sharp, because we are so near to Germany, is lunchtime. Then we start with program again. And at 6 p.m., 18 Uhr, there's a transfer. Buses will take us to the Café Promenade, which will be in a park area in Graz, which is very, very nice. We also have a cabrio bus, which will, depending very, very agile, what the weather will tell us or not. And yes, that's for today. Tomorrow looks equally. We just have the panel discussion at the end, and then a closing and a goodbye. And that's the program. In the program, we have two keynote speakers. Boris Gloga is already here preparing in his mind for the speech, how to HR management. And tomorrow we have Jürgen Appello, agility scales, shifting teams in better shapes. And after the keynote, you will be entertained by our whole tracks and bonus stuff that we have. The future of Agile, which is in Europe Room B, which is behind us actually, the Agile transitions, which are in this room. Then the technical excellence, which are on the third floor. Also the hands-on track is on the third floor in the RIG team. So if it's enough talking from me and you already get bored inside your head, you probably should go there. If you're more the playful type, we have a whole day less simulation with Lego in the Kloiber team on the fourth floor. And if you think all the people, what they're telling you about HL is total something, well, you can go to the coaches clinic. There are people who will try to help you, understand you, and talk to you. Or even if it's everything is fine, it can be helpful to talk to a person who is trained in talking to you and help you with your happy life or your worries. No worries, everything. There are signs everywhere that you probably don't get lost. If you get lost, well, see you tomorrow. So, then some things that need to be said. We have gong, Lin. Mm-hmm. Okay, the gong is gone. We have a timekeeper. Maybe you noticed it's 5 minutes or 2 minutes before we start the session here in this room, and it sounds like this. Okay, so be careful if you have the sound. It's not very loud, but this means we will continue with or without you. Social media is in the house. So, hashtag HL Austria Conference, and you can watch your pictures on the Twitter wall. We also have a feedback wall outside. We want your feedback. There's also something that can be done better, and we want to know it. So don't be shy. If you don't like it, I hope you learned how to give critics in a good way. Then for parking, does somebody has the car here? I guess. During the day, it's, we are sorry, but it's not other possible. You have to pay your day ticket, and overnight you will get an overnight ticket, which is just for standing overnight. So it's not a parking ticket for the next day, it's just overnight. And you get it at the info booth. If you cannot find somebody there, there's a guy called Robert who can help you at any time. The next thing is, don't stick anything to the walls. Especially the coaches. I know we like to work visual, I would guess, so please don't stick anything to the walls. That's it. And Erich Buhler, is he already here? Okay, he has his world book premiere here at our conference, and we are very proud. So later the day, he will set up his table and you can get autographs and talk about his book. So, and we want to give you something back. It's not so that we want your attention, we want to give you something back. So the main organizers thought of some raffles. The first is from Cheap IT, and the simple question is, why is there a comic magazine in the goodie bag? And hopefully there's one in there, because then it gets really, yeah. Yes, so please leave it be. You can search afterwards during the keynote, for example, but not my talk. If you have the answer, we have 20 books for you, and just go to the chip stand. The next is from the company Apus. You just go to the Apus stand, you leave your business card there. They also have pen and paper. If you're too young to have business cards, that's not a problem. And tomorrow at 4:05, they will make a call out, a show out with a great guy who will call, who will be winning. If guys not there, just the next one will be drawn. Also books for education, because we care so much about your mind. And if you're more the playful type, Peering Point has an estimation game with Gummiringel. I hope the 5% who don't get it, it's just a surprise. You will see, you will understand. And you will get a surprise, a Lego Star Wars Technic spaceship, something very cool, very nice. I'm very sad that I cannot play, that I'm not allowed to play. Just go to the Bearing Point, make your estimation, and the winner will be announced tomorrow in the closing. So, that's the raffles. And the most important thing, we don't collect your data. We don't want to be on the same stage like some companies in the USA with the blue logo. So we say, we don't do it. We don't like it. Even Apus told me afterwards they will burn your business card. Afterwards, they will use acid liquid and anything else, that there is nothing left. So it's really just to play with you. That's it. Yeah, well, and I gladly didn't break my time box. It states that the time box can be shorter. It's just the maximum that I need, so there's nothing else for me to say. Just to announce you boys, I'm very glad that you're here, that you are on our conference. I already talked with him yesterday, and, well, what you talked about your company, how you have ideas, or how you're currently implementing the financial structures, how to pay your people, is very interesting, that you let your people decide, right?
Yeah. Yeah, so the basic idea is we try to change to solve the problem in the agile world, how to compensate people in a completely different way. And we created a peer group approach. We worked with the Equal Payment Initiative of Austria to come up with a setting how you can come up with a peer group salary-based management approach. And because one of the issues is, as long as you decide like a, I don't know, boss in who's getting what, it's not really agile, I believe.
And you don't like it, right?
Yes.
Yeah, that's what I thought so. And the most funny quote from you yesterday was like, okay guys, now we do this, 3 sprints, this means in this time, 3 years, live with it, kind of that, and then you will see. And I think that's actually a great idea. So I will switch to your presentation. It's your stage. So thank you very much, and welcome to Austria, Boris.
Good morning. We have so much time, thanks to Philip, because he didn't use his time box. Can you please introduce yourself to your both neighbors in your rows? We have 3 minutes. Come up, let's mingle together. Okay, starts now. Introduce yourself. Where are you? Why are you here? Funktioniert's?
Das war sehr gut. Ich muss dir leider wieder den alten geben. Ja.
Starts nochmal.
Ganz kurz.
Sorry.
Nein, das passt schon.
Jetzt.
Ja.
Alles gut. Alles gut. Okay, this pattern is already known to some of you. So the basic idea of all Agile conferences for the newbies on these kind of conferences is whenever you see someone raising his hand, then you stop talking and you raise also your hand, okay? So let's try it again. Yeah, cool, works. So Agile management, how does it work? And the basic problem of Agile management or Agile leadership was that we, and I confess I was part of the problem, when we started doing Agile, 2001, 2003, I started around about 2002. When we went to the Agile first Agile conference in Salt Lake City, organized by Alistair Coburn and these guys, what we said was more or less like, we don't need management anymore. Ooh. Well, and then we went back to the to our managements and said, we want to do Agile, we don't need you anymore. But you need to help us. So silly idea, right? You go to the people you need for changing the way an organization works, because an organization consists, or the face of an organization is in some way the management. And when you want to transform an organization to an Agile approach, then you go to them and say, by the way, we do Scrum, there's no manager. And a couple of transitions currently are running in the banking industry. And they do exactly these kind of things, right? There's a very large company, and they started to change the way they want to transition to Agile in a way that at first said, first, all management positions are gone. Now we do something like tribes, and though we don't need you anymore. What do you create in this moment? Fear. And all change management experts know when you want to transition to a specific state, to a specific new way of doing things, then the first thing you need to do is you need to secure people. You need to tell them it is completely safe to change. That makes things easier. But, and maybe Jürgen, and he is there tomorrow and you can ask him, one very cool idea of Jürgen was to say, there's something like management and we need to address management. And over the years, I believe the Agile community failed to make absolutely clear what is the new idea of management in an Agile business environment. But when you go to people in the science, in the research area, like St. Gallen, they tell you management is something completely differently than the typical people believe. Management is about implementing reflexive processes, not deciding things. When you decide something, then you're an executive. That's a crazy idea, right? I mean, in that moment when you define management is about creating reflexive patterns, reflexive processes, it's not about deciding, then when I saw that, and when I heard it the first time, I said, well, now they destroyed 95% of all jobs in the management industry because they decide all the time. But if you start to think about, okay, management is about creating reflexive processes that looks a little bit like that what we are doing in the Agile world, right? I mean, we create retrospectives, we create reviews, we do more or less nothing else than a plan, do a check X cycle from Deming. So basically, that is what we try to implement with all our Agile frameworks, regardless if it's Kanban, Scrum, Less, even sometimes Save, I would say, they have a kind of reflexive processes in place. So it's more or less like creating a pattern about how to work with a system. And in my talk, I would like to give you some ideas how to do that. And then it's not really important if you have, and that is maybe the real transition. It's not important anymore if you have a position of a manager to be a manager. Yeah, you don't, I mean, we are in Austria, and in Austria you always have to have these titles, right? I mean, Magister and Doctor and these kind of things. And I created, after 8 years of defending that idea, where I'm a German, I started to have an Austrian business card with Magister and a German one without the Magister. I mean, it's silly to do so. So, but if you are in a society or in a business environment where you have to have titles, you need to come up with ideas how to do these kind of positions, and maybe the real transition in an agile world is to come to destroy the idea you need to have a position to be able to be a manager. And the very first insight in that was Ken Schwaber in his book Agile Software Development with Scrum, published 2001, and he defined the Scrum Master as a management type role. That's one of the crazy things, you know. I mean, most Scrum Masters that we meet in the industry believe they are facilitator, and they have to lead people, and they need to, care for them, but they really completely refuse to say they are managers. But a Scrum Master or an Agile coach is a manager because he manages a process. So that's one aspect. And the other aspect, and that is maybe one idea for you, as if you have maybe bosses or department managers or so, to tell them, why don't you act as a department manager in a type of a Scrum Master? You can stay a department manager, that's fine, but try to act as in a way an agile coach would behave. And what is this? So how to do that? I will explain a little bit of the basics, some principles that you need to apply in your organizations. Maybe I split in a couple of examples and a couple of ideas how to change the way of working in your teams or in your departments or in your groups or whole organizations that are very simple to implement but hard to do, yeah, as it always was. Basics. The very first idea or the very first change in the mindset needs to be that strategy is not a plan. So most people confuse we are strategic with creating huge or long-term planning. So they say strategy is about we want to reach a certain goal. Of course, you need to come up with a certain goal. For instance, one of our goals in our company is to create a sustainable business, and one milestone on that creating a sustainable business as a small consulting company is to say we would like to be at least 150 people. I don't know if this number is the right one, but I believe if a company has a roughly size of 150 people, then it will have a sustainable business. So that's a goal, okay? That's fine. You can do that. Another goal, for instance, of our company is to have an agile company. So everything we do has to be done in an agile way. So it's not only a cultural part of our company, it's a goal, and that has to be set by someone. And you can do that from the boss of a company, general manager, you can do it in your teams, on a team level, it's always the same. You need to come up with certain directions, maybe a goal, maybe a specific constraints. So one of our constraints is we have to have an agile company. So that is a part of your strategy. But the real aspect of your strategy starts to get in place when you behave. So when you start doing things, and this pyramid, it looks like a pyramid, but actually shall be an arrow. As a direction, it starts with leadership. Management is managing processes, but how to behave and work with people is about leadership, is about how you act as a leader, as a Scrum Master, as a department manager, as an agile coach, as a product owner. So how do I behave as a leader so that other people work towards that directions? So we just heard from our company, I wanted to get rid of the idea that I have to come up with the salary ratios and salary increases of our company, of our people. And it's a very hard thing to do, but that was the one thing I really wanted to come up with, a very transparent process. So if I really believe in Agile and this is an issue, then I need to come up with a way to do that. Yeah. So that's one type of your leadership, and that creates a culture. The big problem of an agile culture is you need to help people to transition in their behavior from a traditional type of behavior that we learned in school, in university, in our families, from a more or less social being. You have a hierarchy, you have to follow rules and so on. And these people come into your company again and again and again and again, or they are already there if you have a large company with a long history. So there is an learned style of behavior, that's your culture. And now you want to change that culture and that kind of behavior. And you need to change it because you want to become an agile company. And the only way to do this, and that's the reason why we need to have managers, we need to have leaders in their positions to train your new people in this new way of doing things. And the only one who can do this are the managers. And if they don't know how to do this, they might go to coaches that help them to train these kind of new behaviors. The issue with that is, for the coaches, and that is the sad part for the coaches, what a sad piece of information for the coaches. If all managers had an idea how to behave in a new way, there's no need for coaches, right? And that is maybe the other aspect for the good news for management. If they took the chance or the effort to really learn what management and or agile management might be, and agile leadership might be, then you don't have any kind of problems leading your people again, because you are necessary, right? And we have developed a couple of programs for large banks, for instance, and that's exactly what we do. It's not about training teams and teams and teams and teams. I mean, you can train thousands of teams if you want, and nothing will change in your organization. But if you start working with the managers and they start changing their behavior, then the transition is more or less effortless. That's what I believe. The other thing is structure. You need, if you want to have an agile company, you as a management needs to come up with a structure that helps you to become more agile. And one aspect of, but one aspect of being agile is to bring the decision to the people who are in charge or who have to do the work. Right? I mean, Scrum says the team asks the team because the team decides how to do the work. But on the other hand, that means you need to come up with a structure of your company, your organization, your department, that you are really able to transfer the power of the decision to your people. And for most companies, that's a big, big deal, because the information, the real information that makes decisions possible, are with management. They have all the information. Yeah. They know the numbers. They know the real surroundings. They know the customer sometimes better than the people. They are the ones. I was a first tier level manager in a very large automotive company, and he was the one who went to the dealerships learning what dealers and of this car maker really needed. He started to understand what the dealers really needed, and when you went to the engineers, they said, well, we'll never talk to dealers and dealerships. Yeah, that's crazy. I mean, the upper management still has already access to customers again, but the people who create the products, they don't. So obviously, I need to change the structure from a management perspective to make that happen. Yeah? It has nothing to do with my position. I can't do this. I can't keep my department manager position. But I need to enable people to do these kind of things. And last but not least, and one example was that what we just heard about our way of trying to change the way we base our salary increases, is how to create, the Americans call this people systems, how to create a system for rewarding people in your organization. And some, at least one part of the equation, how to reward people in your organization is money. So you need to come up with a transparent way of doing that. But a much more important aspect of this equation is acknowledgement. Yeah. How to give people the feeling that they are acknowledged, that they are respected, and that is the moment when it ties into the values, for instance, of Scrum, where they say you have to be respectful. So you have to give them not only accountability, but also a kind of reward for that, what they're doing. And it doesn't help And that's one of the other patterns of the Agile community, only to say the team has to be rewarded. It doesn't work. Of course, I need to reward the team first, and I need to come up with team goals. And if you don't see the individual in your team, and that is now the tricky part, you are not allowed to manage the individual in your team, we come to that later, but if you don't see the individual contribution of people in your team, it also will not work, what we have seen in the last couple of years. But if you want to start an understanding how to change the way of working in an agile environment from a management perspective, you first need to come up with a different idea what kind of systems we have. Now something is broken because, So the perception of what is an organization started years ago, and in the late 18th century, with the idea of that a system is more or less a clockwork. Yeah? The universe is a watch, so to say. So the basic idea of the whole perception, how to create a system, how to create a company in the early 20th century by Henry Ford, was to really understand how to slice work into parts, and then I can create a mechanical system like a clockwork in my company. And when you ever have been the chance to go to Detroit, go to the very first factory of Henry Ford, and they show you the history of Henry Ford, and then you will see that he created this super cool company where the material for the cars came by ships on the one side of the factory, and on the other side the Ford Tin Lizzie was cranked out. The only issue was it's just one model, and that's black. So you need to simplify. The whole universe is a clockwork. You can produce it. If it doesn't change anything, it will run and run and run and run and run. The Cartesian approach. The problem with that approach is it doesn't work for humans. And some people believed, whoa, then let's have biological systems in place. So let's not talk about organizations that on as clockworks, but let's talk about organizations like human beings or organisms, biological organisms. And biological organisms have heads, so head off, right? They have branches like a tree, they have divisions, they have parts. So this is in mind, it's an idea that an organization has parts that I have to manage, like in the body, I have to have a backbone. When we started our company, we always talked about our central, we now call it more or less central, because we don't find a better way. In the beginning we start, it's a backbone. So all information goes through the backbone. You know? So that's the idea of having an organization is a kind of an organism. If I believe in that kind of metaphor of my organization, then the job of a management is to manage a part of that specific system, and then I need to implement information systems through backbones, and then you have dashboards, and you have to have the control, and you have a brain, the CEO, the first board, and so on. It's very clear. Everything is steered from the top. I mean, even medicine nowadays knows that this nonsense doesn't work this way. Yeah? We have at least two brains in our body. One is in the stomach, one is in the brain. Then we have a huge amount of network interactions within the body called hormones. So obviously, that whole backbone organism approach is not really working in a biological area. But that's maybe in the next 100 years, we will understand how that really works. The other idea is, and that is the most reasonable approach, and it was developed also in the 70s, so it's not that new, you know. The basic idea is now to understand an organization as a system of communication. So it's not like a system of communication. The important S word is here, is. An organization is a system of communications and nothing more. So not. And that's a very, very, very modern approach, and that leads to a very dramatic conclusion. You can't push communications. I mean, you can you can say a communication, but then you can't take the communication and put it from one point to the other part. So there's no physical possibility of managing communications. You can't control communication. If a rumor is out, then it's out. If an information is out, then it's out. You can't even get it back. Sometimes Outlook tries it, a message is deleted. But you have it already, it's very crazy. So, and you, the problem is you can't control communication. Yeah? You can try it. And then you can come up with public relations and so on and these kind of things. But it's very, very difficult to manage communications in a way that if you, as long as you believe managing communications is about controlling communications. A lot of people believe that is the reason. So let's think about organizations at least for the next half an hour as systems. Less organizations as systems of communications. The sad part of that story is now management is not anymore in the possibility of pushing things through an organization. And that the whole narcissism idea of I can control and as a CEO what happens in my organization is more or less gone. The good part of that information is, or the best part of the information is the super high up level managers in our industry, they got this already. I mean, they understand it. They don't try to work in their organizations anymore in the way that they give orders and commands. They change the whole organizations in a way that they start working in very, very smart ways. They're talking with media. They try to establish communication patterns so that people in their own companies start to believe that there is a change. That's very smart. So the, but the basic understanding, you need to understand you can't push people anymore. So if this is true, if an organization is a system of communications, then our job as managers is to start creating radical transparency. Because the problem is, if someone has more information or gets more communication, a hub, than the other people in your organizations. Politics is a lot about not telling other people what you already know. Information hiding is a part of politics. All these games, okay? On the other hand, radical transparency is the thing the whole industry is moving towards to. Yeah? So IFRS, that's a financial reporting system, the International Financial Reporting Systems, for instance, they imposed that whole idea to the financial people in companies, to the controlling people in companies, explaining to the outside world of a company what really happens from a financial perspective within a company so that investors can anticipate the future. So IFRS is not about what is the current status, it's about what will be the future status. That's a big, big change in the way the money, so the transparency of the numbers is created in these yearly or quarterly reports of the companies. So the other idea is open books. So you go, you dispense all the information, all the financial information, all the management accounting information in your organization, and everybody has access to that. Huh? And that sounds much easier than it is. I mean, even our small company to come up with a management accounting that enabled, that's an agile management account. Nobody created so far I'm not able to read all books and all articles, maybe there's something out, but as long, and I read a lot, but I haven't seen an agile management accounting. But that was absolutely necessary. How do I disseminate all information of my company, also not only the financial numbers, towards the whole organization. One idea that came from uses the ideas of the Kanban world to say, okay, let's have a clear understanding what is our throughput and all these things. But That means I need to understand from a management perspective what really is throughput, how do I manage my throughput, what is important, who is important in all these throughput aspects, and so on. How can I improve my throughput? One idea, but that first I need to collect data and information about the throughput. Only one aspect. The other, all of us knew that, is on team side, on a team basis, we are pretty good in these kind of things. We have task boards, okay? We have reviews. So on this scale, on that very tiny little scale of teams, in most, not in all cases, but in most cases, the dissemination of information is possible and easy. Yeah, we have tasks and daily stand-ups and so on. That's managed. But when it starts, when you come up with the information for the whole organization, then we fall back to cumbersome processes, and the lightest one you can learn tonight or today in the last simulation is maybe this the lightest approach, and then you have these heavy, super heavy approaches in the Agile world to do that, and I don't know if this really works. So salary we talked about a little bit, and the other idea is radical transparency is not only a thing about creating structures and possibilities and infrastructure to be able to do that, it's also a kind of a mindset. You need to have people and you need to train them in sharing their information to everybody, at least within the company. So it's so pushing out information again and again and again and again. So it's not about hiding and you shouldn't wait for getting asked for a piece of information. Push out your information, publish, create internal blogs, if you are not allowed to do them external, but create blogs, disseminate information, write, talk to people, tell them, do open spaces, whatever is necessary to bring out all your ideas to everybody. The funny thing is with that approach, most people believe, well, then again, I can get copied. Yeah, because if I give my all best ideas to everybody. The funny thing is most of the time, when you bring out your ideas, you have already new ones and the other ones will fall back again. Because if they, till they are able to use your own ideas, typically you have already new ones. So no problem with that. So radical transparency is a very, very basic idea and a very important aspect of doing creating an Agile company from a management perspective. This is the provocative message of the whole talk. Work on the system, not on the people. So basically, it says, create an environment and then go away. Yeah? Don't talk to individuals anymore. Yeah? We have, for instance, in our company, we have the rules no one-to-ones. So we don't want to have communication only in a typical dialogue situation, one-to-one. Yeah? So that, but typically, management style is to go to an individual person and talk to the individual person that something is not as it should be. That might be, in some cases, still necessary, but the basic idea should be to avoid as much as possible to go to individuals or work with people, helping people. Let people help themselves. I mean, they are reasonable and usually they are adults, okay? They are accountable for themselves. So create systems that helps people to flourish. And that needs infrastructure. I mean, for the joke to the host of this WKO, nothing, don't put something on the walls, okay? I mean, that's an environment that harms creative work, okay? I kind of completely understand that the facilitation manager doesn't want that. On the other hand, it's an environment that harms people from being creative, yeah? Why are some companies flourishing, like design offices? They create whole offices where you can spread everything on the wall. So, just one idea. So come up with ideas, create environments, maybe you change the office landscape, so that you are really able to have teams and people work as good as possible. And you need to train people in this kind of work. I mean, even especially in Vienna, a lot of companies start to have campuses. But still people don't get it. Yeah, I mean, they're working in a campus, but they are very quietly in one corner and don't talk to the other people in the other corner. That is not the idea, okay? The idea of a campus is that everybody talks to everybody. There's this rumor that Steve Jobs created in Cupertino, this UFO, based on the basic idea that you need as long as possible to get your coffee. Not waiting in front of the coffee machine, but going to this coffee machine, so that you really have to bump into as much people as possible. Yeah? Because this creates creativity. So we said already, set up creative reflexive processes. A lot of people know what I mean with that, Scrum, Kanban, OKRs, retrospectives. The sad information for management, there is already a way of doing Scrum on an organizational level. It's called objectives and key results, implemented within the most successful companies on this planet, Apple, Google, Uber, and so on, okay? It's already done. And the basic idea of this is you have to iterate every 3 months across your with your goals, like in the Scrum approach. You have reviews, you have to come up with clear data, and then you need to change on your approach. It's already there, yeah? It's already done. Some large organizations in Germany starts to prove if that is possible for them, but I believe they are already years and years behind the basic idea that really focus your company. And with all companies that we are talking on, it's always the same. People say our company is very lousy in prioritizing what they have to do, right? And there's an approach. So this is the job of management, to come up with reflexive processes so that you are able to focus your company as good as possible. That's the other aspect I mentioned already. Management does not execute. Ask the team, especially, ask the team, establish accountability, so decide where the information is, not in the terms of that I, as a manager, decide where is the information, then I decide there, but that means the people who have the information should decide. So that is exactly the problem. As long as management has the information, and some companies, management, the upper management or middle management, they have the information, then they have to decide. That's very clear. Yeah. So if you want to change that to an agile environment, then you need to. The first thing you need to do as management to push your information that you have as good as possible into your organization or back to the people who do the work. Structure communication. And the very simplest way to structure communication is having meetings. Sorry for that. The science or the research people, they don't talk about meetings as meetings. They say they call it episodes. It's maybe better, episodes, yeah, because nobody wants to have meetings, but maybe you want to have episodes. But the problem with meetings is most of the time that a lot of meetings are so useless because you just distribute information or blaming or rumors or your current state of mind. Yeah, a lot of blah, blah, blah meetings. So the job of management must be to structure meetings as effective as possible. And you can do it on the scale of your meeting. So very first thing, you need to structure the way the relationship within the group does really work. Then you need to come up with a certain processes for that specific meeting. And then you can let the people bring in the content. So that's the basic idea, that the people that go in the meeting, they structure them, they bring in the content, and management doesn't bring in the content. But most meetings that I attended in these large organizations have the problem that there is no structure, there is no real invitation, there is no real purpose, and sometimes you go out of the meeting and then you ask yourself, why the hell did I went to that meeting? Right? So then go to your bosses, tell them why the hell did have I been invited? So do that, yeah, that's possible. I just went to another company, and some people in that company wanted that I help them to structure the meeting for their boss. That's a bit weird. So that means, obviously, a lot of managers, even if it's their job in a traditional organization, have no clue how to structure meetings very well. Okay. Well, and that is maybe one of the reasons why Scrum and Kanban and all these agile approaches really worked, because that is what they did. We managed, we helped people by understanding how a daily Scrum really works, by understanding how to create an effective sprint planning one, so that we structured these meetings so that they had been effective. Okay, maybe that's one of the very simplest ideas. So come up with workshops that are really structured the communication in a very well way. And the other thing, the one-to-ones, I will come back again. So team-centric, that is maybe the other very important principle. Agile organizations, agile managements need to understand we are working with a team-centric approach. The team, and it is the team. So basically that means my job as a manager is not anymore to talk to the individuals within the team, but always to talk to the whole group of people that I'm responsible for, in some kind of responsible form. Yeah. For instance, in our company, we have, it's not forbidden, okay, but it's just a bad habit to use email or to have one-to-one communications. So we created channels because we are spread across company with a lot of people in certain destinations. So it's not even possible to have always the whole group in the room. So therefore we use tools like MS Teams or Slack to create channels so where we always talk most of the time within these channels. And our consultants on the projects also try to talk as much as possible within groups. Yeah. As much as possible. It's impossible for human beings not to talk to each other when they're sitting in front of a coffee machine and talking with each other. That's fine. Okay. There's no problem with that. The real idea is to create again and again a team spirit by bringing your team together as often as possible. And one approach that is very expensive in our company is we fly in our now 50 plus people every 2 months for 2 days to a very fancy location, and then we have a two-day conference, so to say. To make it happen, that we always have a team-centric approach, that we always understand the work is done in teams and not on an individual basis. That means we need to have team gratifications, we need to understand what is important for teams, what are the goals for teams. So our OKRs in our company, for instance, are based on teams. That does not mean that not everybody else has his own OKRs, but you start with your company OKRs and then you create team-centric OKRs. So. Technique. Sharing. We talked about sharing, but sharing goes much, much more or much beyond the own organization. So in a very holistic approach, in a very open, agile company, my job as a manager to start to spread out the information that we have to the outside world. You might now say, well, you know, as long as it's just consulting, so for instance, Scrum consulting, that will work. But the funny issue is that large corporations like Procter & Gamble, they started to have kind of open innovation initiatives because they figured some very strange problem. If you have a company like Procter & Gamble, and that company of Procter & Gamble needs to increase the value of the organization every year by the size of the economy of Turkey. Okay, you have a company, and the increasing and the numbers that you need to make needs to meet GDP of Turkey every year in increasing. That must be cool for Turkey, right? And you go to Turkey, increase your GDP by 100% per year. And Procter & Gamble said, oh, this is our problem. So if I need to increase my GDP, company GDP, by at least the amount of the whole GDP of Turkey, and I only have 1,500 scientists, that's an issue. I won't get enough information within my company to be able to do that. There's not enough, I mean, it's impossible. So they come up with this super cool idea to come up with an open innovation initiative. So they tapped into this, the whole society of researchers that are important to them, and now they are able to manage 150,000 scientists. Barely without any kind of elements, very cheaply, because these people work for them, because they got the ideas, it's open innovation. But that means, on the other hand, that I need to crank out my own information to these scientists, because they can't work on something that is not there, you know? So you create an ecosystem that is much larger than your organization, and the basic principle is you share your information. The funny thing is, if you share information, you don't lose the information. It's not like sharing money. So, and the funny thing is, the return on investment is such incredibly large, you know? It's insane. I mean, if you see the numbers, you need to go to see the numbers. It's crazy. But and then you go to an KMU in Austria and Germany and explain to them, well, share your information. Go to these entrepreneurs, and they say, oh, completely, I mean, it's impossible. I mean, hiding information, and the IT needs to secure everything, and you are not allowed to go to, using the internet of the company, and all that stuff, because of protection, okay? The complete opposite of that kind of thing, yeah? So sharing information is a very important aspect of creating an agile company, and manager's job is to ensure that people within these teams are happy to share information. So when we go back to my own, when I talk about your own team or your own department, what can you do as a manager to make it easy to share information across maybe first your own team and then across the border of your own department? Okay, last couple of minutes I would like to talk about new ways of working, and I have brought to you three ideas, and most of them you know already. But I strongly believe we need to put much more emphasis on that than we do it in an agile environment. Yeah, we have our task boards, and some people use already the flip charts, and that's fine. And some people use the non-visual way of using a task board called Jira, and that's fine. Yeah. But the point is, you need to make your information as visible as possible to everybody. And the task board is only one simple, small piece in the whole equation, okay? Create radar charts, we called it 10 years ago on conference, big visible charts. Create charts for everything. Create charts for the productivity of your team, for the availability of your teams. Create charts for the defect collections. For one super funny idea came from a friend a couple of years ago. They had a Lego chart for the bugs. Yeah? Why not come up with a Lego backlog? Every defect is a Lego block. Do whatever helps you to make it as visible and touchable as possible. Yeah? And that creates the kind of information dissemination that you really need. And we have, for instance, when I try to work with teams and help them to understand these kind of things, and when I worked with managers in one of the large organizations lately, we create a rule. There is no meeting without a flip chart, and the job of management is to scribe everything down on that flip chart. The problem of scribing for most people is they want to think while they scribe. So they try to reduce the sentences, or they try to come up with super cool words or so, and that slows down the scribe process. Write down what people say. Yeah? That makes the thing much faster. But that's a very simple idea, and some people tried that out after we did a kind of a class with them and then a program, and we worked with them, and after two or three times they came up with, wow, that was super beneficial. I mean, I didn't say nothing in that meeting. I just wrote down what people said, and they came up with super cool solutions. That's the idea. Make communication visible. If an organization is nothing else than communication, then it is super easy, it's very helpful to make the communication visible. The next thing is, in certain ways, for instance, you can create different kind of meeting formats, like the circle way is a very simple idea. You create a circle with chairs, and everybody has to sit in that circle. The basic rule is everybody has to say what they want to say and not for someone else, so they are their own chairman, and then everybody is allowed to talk clockwise and only clockwise as long as they want, and sometimes you have to sit there for 15 minutes if it's 10 people before you can say yourself something, because someone needed to talk a very long, yeah, that's fine in the beginning. It's a very simple idea called circle way. Look it up in Google. You will find it very, very easily. And the basic idea is to slow down communication and to help people really to listen. Yeah, listening is more important than talking, besides you do as on stage. And that is one idea of facilitation of communication, of facilitation of work, helping people to communicate better. Another idea is, if you want to have it on a department level, you can do open space formats. Open space format, for instance, in our company, is the way we structure our company. So maybe you have been to an open space conference. The basic idea is, whoever wants to create a session, aka team, aka projects, explain he would like to create a team, aka project, if he invites people to his session or project, and then people join if they feel they can contribute or learn something in that project or session. And that's exactly how we structure our organization, the way we are working in large distances. We have channels, so we have a virtual marketplace, and this marketplace, people say what they want like to do, what needs to be done. Sales explain we have a new proposal or a new contract to fulfill, and the people who would like to fulfill this kind of contract, they just join and they do the job. So it's possible even on a large scale environment to structure the whole organization in a way using an open space idea. And then there you have other formats, and that is the way that you can learn. So the message here, learn to become a good facilitator as a manager, because your job is to manage reflexive processes. And the last thing, again, was more or less invented by software developers. It is like it is. It's called hackathons. The very first idea was hackathons. Everybody works together on only one thing, so that helps you to focus. It creates the basic idea in the lean environment of the one piece flow, because one team works for 24 hours on one thing, and only one thing, and then they are finished, and then they maybe start the next thing. It's a one piece flow. And if you go with that idea further, then there was an idea invented called mob programming or flash working, and that is the basic idea. The whole team works on one piece of the problem. It can up to 24 or 5 people and more. One computer, maybe one keyboard, and everybody has to type, but only the one who is typing is not allowed to think. He's only allowed to type what the other tell him that he has to type or she has to type. And that's basically the idea of mob programming or flash working. And the basic idea of that is just one scenario. If you take that idea and apply it to everything, to every workshop, to every problem of your company, to every department of your problem, to every team, to every issue that you really want to develop, then it means that you bring in as much perspective as possible, so you invite complexity in your problem solution instead of pushing complexity out by structuring it. And it might be a little bit confusing at the beginning, but most of the time these flash working approaches are much, much faster if they are facilitated properly. And you can do these kind of things again and again. And design thinking, sprint planning, hackathons is always the same idea. Bring the whole team together, let them work together with a clear challenge in front of them, and then help them to manage these processes within that, that flash working approach, for instance. Okay, that was more or less the idea. We have basics. The basics are what kind of systems do we manage as a manager in an agile environment? And the basic idea is here to say, let's have a clear understanding that we manage a system based on communications. We don't manage people, we manage the communication. And if we manage communications, then we need to make sure that we can make that, that communication as transparent as possible. We need to come up with solutions that are very, I mean, they need to be tailored to your specific needs, of course, but you need to come up with solutions to broaden the way to create as much noise in your company as possible. And then there are some type of ideas how to manage that kind of work on a team-based approach, for instance, creating kind of workshops, doing maybe more programming or flash working in that way. Thank you very much. Any questions? Philip, you have the micro. There's a question.
Perfect.
Thank you. Thank you very much for the really interesting inputs. You talked about a lot of managing communications. Mm-hmm. The thing that instantly comes to my mind in that thing, if you facilitate communication, then you have to handle communication and information overload at some point,
yeah.
Because we always, you know, if you start using Slack and Slack channels, and people always complain about, well, there is so much going on, there's so much communication, I might miss the important part.
Yeah.
So, well, how's your approach to that?
So now the manager talks needs to talk again in terms of, or the other approach of, or the other aspect of being a manager is to create a secure environment. As I said, you need to come up with safety. And you need to tell people it's completely okay if you miss something. So the basic idea is we will have, by this approach, we will have a huge amount of abundancy. We will create information, and it's set again, and it's set again, and it sends something, and you will come across it. It's a huge amount of abundancy. Yeah? And some people will get the information, some not. That's fine. Because everything else didn't work. Okay. I mean, it won't work. Yeah? I mean, for instance, if you go to the internet, I mean, it's millions of websites. You can't read everything. I mean, it's impossible.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
And how would you make sure that the people won't miss the really important information?
I don't make sure that they don't miss the real information. It's okay. And what will happen then? Maybe they do something wrong. And we have an iterative approach. What will happen if we have a review after 2 weeks and they did something completely weird? Well, then I might understand that in my organization, we need to come up with shorter cycles so that I get a better information. So as long as I don't understand, or as long as I'm not, you need to come up with a system, that is exactly why we need to have these reflexive processes, that shows you if people, if you are the one who has the information, also have the information, right? That's the reason why you have to have reviews. If they go in the wrong direction, you can add enough or more information if necessary.
Okay, thanks.
Somebody else?
Philip, yeah.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Ah.
Can it happen that the noise gets too loud at some point, you know? if too many tools are used for communication, because everybody can choose if they want to use Skype or Skype for Business or MS Teams, and you create channels everywhere, and you have open spaces, and you invite everybody always for meetings, be open. I have the feeling sometimes people get too distracted.
Yeah. What are the most innovative cities on the planet? Small ones or large ones? No, the large ones. The research shows that the most innovative cities on the planet are the larger ones. They are more robust. The problem is you get a lot of, I mean, you create abundancies, and if you create abundancy, then you have a lot of loss, right? Sure. The end, of course, you need to come up with, we always get the same question. I mean, for instance, in our company, we restricted our communication channel to one tool. It's called MS Teams. So, because it doesn't make sense to have Slack and MS Teams in parallel, running parallel. Okay. That is one way of trying to help people to at least have one communication channel. That is fine. But if we are only a 50-person company, if I were a company with, I don't know, 50,000 people, I mean, let them use what they need. I mean, who cares? As long as they produce something, right? I mean, if they are completely unproductive, then we need to come up with some new ideas, of course. Someone else?
I agree with a lot of your points, yeah.
Thanks.
But one of your points, I was not really sure because of the sharing. You mentioned sharing in a real excessive way. This means also that you share all your information, as far as understood, also from the organizational point of view, and from my experience, especially with hierarchical organizations, big organizations, telecoms, whatever you mean, I can imagine how to explain them that they should share all the informations to the whole world, to the rest of the world, because these are
They will push me out of the door, of course. I mean, it's sure, clear. It's a completely different mindset. And of course you might you need to understand from your your own company, what do you believe is your real secret you won't share? Okay, that might be the case in certain types, and then we have laws. We are not allowed data protection in, I don't know, 1 week or 10 days or something. Of course, the government says we are not allowed anymore to share these kind of things. That is fine because it's an information that doesn't belong to me. Okay, that's the point from the Data Protection Act. But the funny thing is, do you want to be on the innovative side or do you want to be on the exploitation side? And if you want to be on the exploitation side, it might be very useful that you come up with specific processes that exploit a specific niche. Okay, 18 years later, the typical lifespan of a company, you are dead. Fine. That's okay. It's a decision. Yeah, 18 years is the Halbwertszeit of a company. So yeah. Most companies after 18 years are not there anymore. Something else? Here, there's.
Hi. You talked about radical transparency, and we are discussing this very often in our company. Do you have any hints on getting there? Because the discussion in our company is always about from 0 to 100% to radical transparency from one day to another, step by step, then always the discussion is where to start, where to end. Any hints on that?
Any hints on that?
Experiences?
It depends on what kind of information you would like to make transparent. So we started, and that was from the very first time on, was we started, of course, with our knowledge. So we shared our knowledge. Right? That's the easy part. But the second part was to start with the financial information. And it took us a while, but this was already 8 years ago, till we had an information system running. I worked with our tax lawyer and accountants and so on to come up with a real monthly report for all the information that is for the whole company. Everybody knows everything now. So That's the management accounting issue, but then it's financial accounting. Now we need, at the moment we are working on management accounting stuff. So utilization, I mean, we have a dashboard for utilization, all that stuff, but this, that is the typical approach. The real issue was the salary part, okay? And there is a sad issue with that. It is not allowed. You as a company are not allowed to ask your people, it's important, it's still forbidden. You are not allowed to ask your people to open up the information about your salary. You're not even allowed to ask for that, okay? And you are not even allowed to have a spreadsheet on your servers with the salary information to everybody. We talked to lawyers about that. But that's up to the people. If they want to do that, then they can do it privately, right? I mean, create a Google account, that's up to them. That was basically the approach of that they took. Some of our people said, we would like to show what they are earning, and they did it, fine. I have no idea about that, you know. And I don't know where it is.
Thanks.
Okay.
Thank you very much. This was the keynote from Boris Gloger. I'm very grateful. Thank you very much, and a big applause, please.
Thanks.
And there's nothing more to say than enjoy the conference and let's have a break of 15 minutes.